All right, welcome back, students. In this set of videos, we're going to talk about Catherine MacKinnon's article, Frances Biddle's Sister. And in class, when we meet, you're going to get an opportunity to talk about a test case involving an actual law that MacKinnon drew up, because she is a law professor, not just a law professor, but a very, very good one, renowned. And to pursue the goals that she writes about in this article, she actually wrote laws that got passed in Minneapolis and Indianapolis banning certain types of pornography. And you'll see that it's legally significant that her law bans only certain types of obscene pornography. That's what ends up creating the legal issue that we're going to deal with in our test case. So in these videos, be watching for that question to emerge. MacKinnon's argument is that pornography, especially pornography which depicts the subordination of women, undermines the equal democratic citizenship of women. It tells men this is what women want, and no matter what women say, they won't be heard. Their influence over this moral issue that affects them so greatly is, she says, essentially nil, because men believe that women want it like porn shows them wanting it. And her law would target precisely this type of porn, especially porn that shows women in subordinate positions being raped or beaten or brutalized or presented as objects to be used by men, or any porn really that shows people subordinated, raped, brutalized, objectified, heterosexual, homosexual, bi, queer, anything. You saw her make that argument. The laws that she drafted and got passed actually brought together a very strange coalition of liberal law professors, feminist scholars, and conservative pastors. So the story of those laws is really going to be interesting for us to delve into. Now, MacKinnon says that most discussion of pornography and the law unconsciously assumes two things that she doesn't want to assume. The first is that you can talk about the abstract freedom of, you know, quote, people. For instance, when discussing Roth, I did a lot of talking about the freedom of people to sell or view pornography. And I talked about how that was defined by the court in Roth as an unprotected right, something that fell outside of the bounds of the First Amendment. But MacKinnon says, hey, look, let's face it, when we're talking about pornography, we're talking mostly about men. The issue is not about the freedom of people to view pornography, but the freedom of men to view sexual pictures and read sexual depictions, and that's most often depictions of women. So if we're talking about pornography being thought and pornography being speech, then what we're talking about is what men think and say about women. The second unconscious assumption in most legal discussions of pornography, MacKinnon says, is that you can talk about obscene pornography without being obscene yourself. So for instance, the court talks about prurient interest and lewd contact with the genitals, and people will speak euphemistically about private parts. But MacKinnon says that the attempt here is to separate pornography from polite company and to distance oneself from what hardcore porn really is and what it really does. Now, as you've seen, Catherine MacKinnon in her article doesn't go in for either of these polite tendencies. She doesn't want to abstract away from what's really going on in pornography. So she calls a spade. She uses the words that men use to describe what they see in pornography. Obscene words, four-letter words. She argues that pornography depicts women being used and abused by men, and it makes women, all women, into objects to be used and abused by men. Now, in this lecture, I'm not going to do what MacKinnon does. I'm still going to speak a bit euphemistically about these issues, but I'm going to show you some of the quotes from the text in a slightly cleaned up form, and I urge you to actually go to the text and look at her argument about the language that we use to describe pornography, and look at the actual quotes in the original to see if they have the impact that she says they do. Okay, so let's get into MacKinnon's argument. It's not, you have seen, the standard argument about the objectification of women, because MacKinnon doesn't just see some sort of psychosexual process of objectification going on. She sees something very specific, very political, that pornography does. She argues that it makes women unequal in society because it makes them things to be used and abused by men in all aspects of social and political life, and it silences women, making it so that men refuse to listen to them, even on these issues of what women want. So if it's men's freedom to view pornography that harms women's equality, she doesn't see any reason to protect that freedom, the abstract freedom of speech of men. And you see, MacKinnon argues that this loss of equality is also a loss of freedom for women, because they are made to do and to be things in society that they do not wish to do and be. So this leads MacKinnon to absolutely reject the million libertarian idea that fostering a marketplace of ideas is the best way to secure freedom for all. She says that all this marketplace has meant in practice is that those with more money can buy more speech, and so they end up gaining the power to determine what is said, what is thought, what is believed in our society, and she says, even what is done in our bedrooms. In fact, she says that the power of men has been used in this so-called free marketplace to define women as sexual objects and to steal women's voices away from them. Because men have the power to perpetrate this type of pornographic speech, then they have the power to make it seem as if women want to be in this subjugated position that they're put in by and in pornography. So you hear it out of men's mouths all the time. She wanted it, right? As a description of date rape, as a description of what a young woman might wear to a bar. What a man does when he says she wanted it is he makes his vision of her sexual desires, a vision that is perhaps taught to him by pornography, to override her voice. She says she was raped, but he thinks he knows better. She wanted it. You know how I know she wanted it? I saw women want it like that before. So MacKinnon says that the harm that pornography does to women is not perceptible as harm because men will refuse to see it. And it doesn't matter that a woman calls it out because men will just say she wanted it. So what good is a harm principle, she asks, when what Mill calls the tacit understandings of society refuse to acknowledge the harm that is done? She wanted it. MacKinnon says this is a harm to women's equality. When women lose their voice, when they're not taken to be the definitive voice even on these moral issues that affect them most, rape, marital sexual abuse, other sexual issues, then the traditional assumption that we're all a part of the social decisions that we make together has been violated. And women lose their freedom too, MacKinnon says. They have to be what men make of them in pornography, because if they try to object, they simply won't be believed. Men won't believe that women don't want what pornography portrays them as wanting. So on page 166 of Frances Biddle's Sister, she says this. You'll see the quote appear in front of you. If women's freedom is as incompatible with pornography's construction of our freedom as our equality is incompatible with pornography's construction of our equality, we get neither freedom nor equality under the million free speech calculus. Equality for women is incompatible with a definition of men's freedom that is at our expense. What can freedom for women mean so long as we remain unequal? Why should man's freedom to use us in this way be purchased with our second-class civil status? So now you see here, quite fully, how MacKinnon can be classed among what we are calling the democratic speech theorists. Free speech, she assumes, is only fully consistent with our tradition when it's offered as arguments in a public debate that takes seriously the moral equality of all, the equal power of all to make moral decisions and to make democratic social decisions as well. Speech, which steals this equality away, which makes some people unheard in some debates on some important issues, may make some of us more free to speak, but only at the expense of others. And MacKinnon thinks that it was never the point of rights that some should be free to set the policy while others are unheard and forced to accept the policy no matter what they say against it. And so MacKinnon argues that Roth and Miller kind of got the story wrong a little bit. It's not that pornography has no worth as ideas for social and political change and therefore comes in for no protection under the First Amendment. It's that pornography positively undermines the democratic citizenship of women, especially when it comes to social issues dealing with sex, and maybe when it comes to all social issues. And she believes that no freedom can be justified which undermines equal democratic citizenship in this way. Okay, so it's been a while since I spoke directly to you like this, and one of the things you've noticed is that I do this when I want to focus on some writing, reading, or analytical skill that you're going to want to pick up for this course. I'm going to talk to you right now for just a minute about critique, and I want you to think about it as something you can exercise and practice heading into your final paper, where it may come in handy for you. One of the things I want you to notice in these lectures about MacKinnon is how she's engaged in that thing called critique. The first video basically explained the substance of her views. The next one is going to take a look at the way that she uses particular pieces of text from Roth and Miller and how she critiques them. What I want you to notice is how she does it. Do you remember when I used that word to describe the third part of a thesis? What, why, and how? Same thing here. Now, you might have heard of critical theory before. It's been a big deal in academia for at least the past 25 years. When people use that term, though, they're often referring to something more specific than the general term that I'm using here. Critical theory often refers to a left-leaning form of theory, which is also the type of theory MacKinnon is doing here, but I also want you to notice the genre that she's engaged in, not just the type of theory that she's doing. So critical, used more broadly, is about how we question ideas. A critique generally summarizes and evaluates a text. So in the next video, I want you to be looking at both of these things, how MacKinnon summarizes and how she evaluates. As she summarizes, she's not just repeating the words of a text, she's highlighting the concepts in it that you ought to find questionable. So it's summary with a purpose, not just repetition of the ideas of a text, but circling in for the kill. Then as she evaluates, she takes the words she's isolated in Roth and Miller, and she starts asking questions about how they're used. She wants to understand the assumption behind them, and you'll see she's also really concerned about how they're used in society, because that's one of the assumptions behind critical theory. There's no such thing for critical theorists as a pure discussion of ideas. Ideas are always meant to be used for a purpose in society, and for the critical theorists, they want to point out the way that ideas are used to implement and reinforce power. That's at least one reason why critical theory generally tends to lean more left. So what I want you to notice in the next video is how MacKinnon critiques. She circles around a piece of text, and then she goes in for the kill. Now, critique might have weaknesses as a form of argument. The opponent in a critique is static. It's a text. It's not a dynamic opponent that might actually respond to you. So one of the things you may see is that MacKinnon perhaps spends less time thinking about how you or someone else might respond to her views, more time thinking about how Roth and Miller and John Stuart Mill are wrong. Next week, we'll actually take a look at a debate and debate as a genre of argument that you also might want to think about for your final paper. It has its strengths and weaknesses too, but for now, let's just focus in the next video on how MacKinnon performs critique. Ask me questions about that in class. All right, I'll see you in the next video.